Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
Hey, what's going on, guys? This is Zeke. This is Dogumentary TV, YouTube channel for dog lovers. If you guys have not already, please go ahead and subscribe to the channel. Today we have a guest, a very special guest, one of the first dog trainers that I was able to work with as Dogumentary TV. She is a legend. I'm sure her legend expands beyond Southern California. I noticed that when I posted her videos, there were folks from all over the country, at the very least, singing her praises. So today, we're going to talk with Mrs. Leri Hanson. Hello.
Hi, Zeke. How are you
doing? I'm wonderful. How you doing?
I'm good. Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for making the time to share your knowledge, your wisdom, and all of your experience with my my audience. First and foremost, and that's not just for tonight, because you have helped me in a lot of ways in terms of, I think you're one of the first dog trainers who I actually did a video for. And then I think you've put me in contact with a lot of people who subsequently helped me make other videos about dog training.
Nice.
And everyone who, anytime I mention your name in the community, doors open for me. So awesome. You have a great reputation locally. I'm sure. I don't know. What's your international presence? If you have one.
I don't really have one. I the only thing I've done internationally with the breed, with the pit bulldogs, is I've been to Italy a few times. I love my Italian friends and family. I've been to Panama, not with the pit bulls, but with French ring training. I've been to Canada, Mexico, France. The dogs have opened some really wonderful doors for me as well, too. And I've met some great people and had some wonderful experiences.
Okay. Well, I will say this. I know that for a fact that when I posted your video, there was a ton of people who weren't necessarily in Southern California who responded to your name. So your reputation definitely is larger than just our local community.
Well, that's good to hear, Zeke, because I was a little nervous. I'm like, gosh, I've been away so long, I wasn't sure anybody would log in tonight. So I hope some people do.
No, we have some people here. It'll probably grow. This is kind of a last minute thing, but it'll be up so people can still watch it after the fact. So let's start from the beginning. How did you get into dog training?
I was originally into horses as a child. My dad got horses for my sisters and I, and we boarded them. And from there, it was becoming kind of expensive, so we decided to buy property where we could have horses. We did that for several years, and I competed with them. And then I got married, and it was a little more difficult to afford the horses, so we downsized to dogs. And one thing led to another, and I've always been a little competitive, I guess, with the animals. So if I wasn't competing horses, I was in competing dogs.
Right. How did you land on the well, who taught you how to train dogs? Are you self-taught, or did you take courses or apprentice or something?
I'm sure he's long gone now, but there was a gentleman by the name of Joe DeBeck, and he did a little basic dog training class behind the pet store a couple nights a week. And I took our first pit bull there, and the dog graduated. Frazier, he graduated at the top of the class, and Mr. DeBeck said, you know, there's a dog show. You might want to consider, you know, checking it out with him. He's pretty good. And that's when I was first introduced to the United Kennel Club obedience. And I went out to watch the obedience trial, and there was actually a confirmation show going on. And I'm like, whoa, that was really neat. I didn't expect that. So that's kind of how it started. Just I happened upon it.
Okay. Larry, can you do me a favor? Just move a little closer to the phone, because I'm just having a little trouble hearing you. Yeah. I think that might be better.
Better?
Yeah, better. So how did you land on the pit bull as a breed? I guess that's your breed, right?
Mm-hmm. I blame that all on my husband, because he had a pit bull when we were dating, and that was one of the reasons I actually went out with him, is because he had kind of a neat pit bulldog, and we used to go to the park, and he'd say, Aldo, dig, and Aldo would, and the last thing you'd see is his tail. He'd go down that fast and that far. Aldo was kind of a troublemaker, though, and from there, Aldo lived with his parents, though, and so we decided to get one of our own, and we picked up an old penny saver. You might be too young to remember the penny saver. It was a free paper. And there were some purebred pit bulls for sale for a couple $100s. And we went and checked one out and checked them out and brought one home. And I'm like, well, first thing I have to do is put it in obedience school, because my dad always obedience trained his dogs, not competitively, but through Parks and Rec. And there we went. Yeah.
Okay.
And the pit bull, I knew even back then, the reputation wasn't great. So I was a big believer in, look what I can do with my pit bull. I can put it on a downstay with all these dogs walking around. And I was very, very proud of that. What I believed then compared to what I believe now is very different. It's night and day. But I was bound and determined I was going to try and change the world on what these pit bulls were all about. It's all in how you raise them. That isn't true.
Right.
Now I know that, but back then I believed it. So I was out to make a point.
Right. So, the pit bulls, American Pit Bull Terriers, are great dogs. They're wonderful animals. How are they as, what have you found them to be in terms of sports competitors?
If you've got a good one, they can do it. They'll allow you to play and maybe sometimes even win a little bit. If the Malinois are having a bad day, the pit bulls can beat them. If the Malinois are having a good day, the pit bulls can still place. But head to head, you're not going to beat them at their own game, just like they're not going to beat us at our own game. But a good pit bulldog with an experienced handler, there's not a whole lot that they can't do.
Right. So let me ask you, typically, the idea of human aggression isn't necessarily genetically supposed to be in an American Pit Bull Terrier. Is that something that you have to fight through, or is that, as a dog just seen in his play when he's doing the sporting thing?
Yeah, that's a really good question, Zeke, because I've always been a believer in that too. And even with my sport dogs, I was made a big point that I wanted to be sure that the dog was on the equipment, that it wasn't looking at the man as a real fight. However, there are some very serious high-end competitors with their pit bull dogs that they want a dog that goes both ways. The dog can compete, can be out in a social setting perfectly fine, and also protect them if need be. And I didn't believe that you could have that. I think you can. You have to have the right dog, and you have to have the right mindset and be very, very able, ready, and willing to protect that dog under all circumstances. And that's kind of how I look at it, is we need to protect our dogs, because when they get in trouble, it hurts a lot of people, not just them. So there are people that do that. And originally, too, I kind of butt heads with people that were using them for personal protection. I'm like, no, don't. That goes against the grain. And then I thought to myself, shoot, people are telling me that it goes against the grain even to do sport protection. And I'm like, you could handle my dog. Anybody could handle my dog. They're not looking at that decoy or that bad guy as a real fight. It's a game for them. So I kind of had to open my mind a little bit to what they are capable of. And there are a lot of guys and gals that are using them for personal protection as well as sport and home companion. And I'll be really honest with you. The older I get and in today's society, the idea of a personal protection dog sounds pretty darn good to me too. So I don't know if I have one suited. Maybe Real Deal Dave will help me find out, but we'll see.
Real Deal Dave, yeah. That's one of the guys that I've worked with in the past. He's a good dude.
One of your videos with him when he got attacked by the
mountain
that's
lion.
One of my favorite Dogumentary TVs.
Oh, yeah. Thank you. Yeah. I appreciate that. That video was made possible by him being brave and crazy at the same time. The fact that he actually videotaped the mountain lion up in a tree, I told him, we got to make that video.
I recently met him and I have nothing but respect for the guy. Super cool guy, family, business, a lot of props go there.
Yes, yes, yes. Who else do you work with? Well, just right up front, we know you work with Kari Smoke.
What's Kari? I haven't seen Smokey in years.
Oh, really?
Although I think the last time we were together, he was doing the decoy work for us. I haven't seen Kari for years, but Al Banuelos I train with regularly. Oscar Mora has been wonderful. I'm recently training with Jean-Luc out at PH Dogs in Europa Valley. They've been real good too. Yeah. Juan Mendoza, when I can, he's just hard to get in with also, Oscar, but yeah.
Right.
Al Banuelos was my original mentor, and so it's really great to be reconnecting with him. So.
Right. As we were talking earlier, you said you consider yourself to be somewhat of a gateway trainer. You want to explain that concept to me?
So we started working Pitbull Central, probably 12 years ago, and it was intended as a place where people who had bull breeds, any breed could come, still can, bull breeds that the person wanted to get involved with some sort of sport, whether it be weight pull, obedience, therapy dog, that's not a sport, but a service dog, therapy dog, protection, agility, and tracking. Not that I was or I consider myself an expert in all of those things, but I know enough to get them started. And that's kind of even how it is now with the few people that we have in the group. We've got some super, super nice young pit bulldogs. I wish they were mine. There are three of them that are exceptional dogs. New handlers, new trainers, and I can get them so far, but then I need to move them along. They need to see real decoys, and they need to be surrounded by a training club that supports their idea and their goals, because it takes a village, to do any of it, really.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Someone was asking about Wes. Have you seen him lately?
I saw Wes, maybe a month or two ago. I brought him out on one of our Saturday mornings, and the old guy still looks good. He still got it too. We put him up on a kind of a spring pole, and he had a good time. Yeah, nice. He's a good dog.
Yeah. So Hung, I forget Hung's last name. What's his last name?
Trong.
Hung Trong. Yeah. So what's his first name? Because I might have pronounced his first name wrong.
Hi
Trong. Okay, hi. I was putting them together. Mm-hmm. Hi Trong. Right. Okay. Perfect. Yeah, he was a great guy again. That's someone that I met through you. And we did the Living with the American Pitbull Terrier. That was one of my favorite videos, because I just felt like he did a lot with the dog, and the dog had a full life, Like he did a lot. Like not only did he do the protection training, not only did he live with him, he lived in the house. I mean, if you follow High on his Instagram, you see the dog, I think he goes fishing, does all kind of crazy things and wonderful things, hiking, trips and all that stuff with that dog. So that's
High is probably one of the best dog owners, period, of any breed. I mean, he really has a lot of love, a lot of concern. The dogs don't want for anything in regards to, being strong and healthy and enriched mentally, physically. He's an excellent owner. Yeah, he's a good guy. Good friend of mine.
Yeah, he was. I really enjoy spending time with him. So what I want to do now, we kind of just give a baseline. How long have you been training dogs? I'm sorry, I didn't get that yet.
I hate to say it, like over 30 years.
30 years, okay.
I mean, professionally, I'm not doing it professionally anymore. I kind of am, but pretty much retired now that my husband is too, because we do a lot with the grandkids. The first probably 10 years, I just did sport, and then I went professional a little bit. Now I'm kind of back to just sport and working with a small group of friends. Yeah.
Okay. Well, what we can do, what I want to do is open it up to the audience, give them the opportunity to ask you questions. One of the things I love about these live things is because when I started Dogumentary TV, one of the ways that I was able to get information, because I'm not a dog expert by any means. I have resources like yourself, people who I talk to, who give me solid information, who I can then kind of create a video around and share that with them. But it's conversations like this where I ask questions that I don't know the answers to, and then I tell it to them like I know the answer, right? So this is a little trick I do. But anyway, so for them to have the opportunity to talk to someone of your stature, someone with your experience, I think is great. So if you guys are out there, if you guys want to, okay, someone's already called in, so you guys already know the routine. In the description of this video, there's a link. If you click on that link, it will allow you to call into the show. Once you call into the show, you can ask your question to Mrs. Hanson. We want to keep the scope of the questions around dog training and maybe a little light protection training, I guess. Not much more than that, right? All right, here we go. We have Stetson is calling in. Hey, Stetson, how's it going? You muted yourself, bro. Can you unmute yourself? Might be stuck. I don't know. It's not looking good for you, Stetson. All right, we're going to try. I'm going to let Stetson go, and we can try someone else later. If you guys want to call in. Make sure you have good Wi-Fi connection so that we can see your video move and you can talk to us. But like I said, in the description, there is a link that will allow you to call into the show. What's your plan for this summer? We're kind of coming out of a year where everything was shut down, so a lot of people have big plans.
Yeah, it was it was actually a good thing for me. I took a couple of years off of training altogether. No dogs, no training, no sport, and January 2020, I got these two young pups. And then pandemic hit. So I was fortunate enough to, at least in February, get to a Nino Drowart STS canine. And that was put on by Ben Davidson down in San Diego. And that was so inspiring for me. And I was really, really gung-ho to work. And I loved his program. I still love his Nino's program. Unfortunately, these pups weren't so much suited for that type of training. But I worked hard every day with them, and then they didn't work out for me. But I have a little Staffy Bull Terrier right now, my very first one, and she's dynamite. I like her a lot. Nice. a lot. So I'm hoping to do a brevet, maybe a ring one with her, and who knows, maybe a little PSA, maybe a little Schutzen. Just gonna have a good time.
Okay, perfect. Well, I have another guest. He's already actually done this show before. He's a great dude. You know him well. You mentioned him earlier. He's got a goofy smile on his face. I'm looking at it. Okay, here we go. Oscar, what's going on with you, brother?
What's up? What's up? How you guys doing?
Good. How are you?
Hey, what's up, Larry?
You working dogs? I'm good.
Real quick. Nah, I'm cleaning the garage.
Okay.
Hey, real quick. I just wanted to call in and say Larry was probably one of my first mentors, one of my first, like, three. And that went out of her way to help me out. And so, you know, I just want to let you know, thank you for everything. I really appreciate you. And your name is going to be known for a long time in the dog game. So
thank
just
you,
wanted
Oscar.
To call in and give you a shout out, Larry.
Thanks, Oscar. I appreciate that.
All right.
Thanks a lot, Oscar. Appreciate you, bro. All right.
You got it.
All right, thanks. Cool. I mean, honestly, that's the kind of energy I get whenever I talk to someone about you. I mean, everyone's like, you're like an institution within Southern California. I can't think of one. Go ahead.
That's the thing about Oscar. When Oscar came out to our group, and of course, I was with the SoCal All Breed Ringers, and we did embrace all different breeds, and Oscar came out with a Corso. So I'm like, yes, that was super cool. And he was so gung-ho. I like that. You know, I like that a lot. I gravitate towards it. And Oscar has, man, he's turned into absolutely one of the best. You know, right. Really, really impressed with what he's done.
Yeah, no, Oscar's a great guy. So you're talking about the off-breed thing. I know that's one of your other things. You kind of you're a champion of the underdog the underdog, right? So, so what are your thoughts on or what is your advocacy for off-breed dogs competing in dog sports?
Oh, I'm all in favor of it. However, I do believe that the owner needs to have realistic expectations. And if the dog isn't ready, don't put them in. If the dog is out of control, hopefully they'll work a little bit harder, because any breed that goes out there and has to be dismissed because they're out of control, it looks bad, but it looks doubly bad when it's one of our off breeds. In fact, I was watching an event, a big event not long ago, and one of the dogs broke the long down and charged the working dog. And it was over really quick, no problem, no foul. And nobody talked about it afterwards. And I kept thinking to myself, you know, if that had been my dog that broke the down, or if another dog had broke the down on my bulldog, boy, that would have been talk of the town. Right. So we have to be really, really careful about that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Right.
But otherwise, I say go for it. And if I can help you, let me know.
All right. Perfect. Perfect. Guys, if you want to call in and ask some questions, again, there's a link in the description of the video. Just click on that link and you can call in like Oscar just did. So are there any clubs, like, for, we're in Southern California, are there any clubs that you would recommend people check out?
You know what? So that's a really good question too. When I got out of training a couple of years ago, and I had planned on just taking a little break, I didn't plan on leaving my original club. And when I came back, or when I tried to come back, I didn't know it was going to be so hard to get back into a club, because everybody's a business now. And I mean, as you know, dog training's not cheap.
No.
And to get into a sport is not cheap. So the people I was hoping to train with, I just couldn't afford, it just was out of my budget. And the people that were willing to help me for a reasonable amount was when it worked out for them, when the time suited them. Even the people that in my gateway training that I've said, okay, it's time for you to move on, it's been difficult getting them moved on as well too.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of great trainers and good clubs out there, but good luck getting into them. A lot of times the training's done during the week where most people work during the week.
Right.
Weekends now, it appears that a lot of the trainers, the competitive trainers anyway, are reserving weekends for their own dogs. They're working other people's dogs all week, so they need time for their own dogs as well. So it's a little bit tricky. It's a little bit tricky. That might be part of the reason why two more new clubs are forming, but new clubs generally come with minimal experience, and then it's a trial and error, and it's all good. I mean, that's how we all start. But there are a lot of people out there training. It's just trying to, here's the other thing too, is when you get in with a club, it kind of becomes like a family. You spend a lot of time with these people, a lot of holidays with these people. Sometimes you're dragging your kids, or sometimes your grandkids with you. And it's got to fit. Sometimes it might be the best training available in your area, but it just doesn't fit, doesn't work out for you. And it's no offense, no personal offense, just not working for you. Then you move on to the next. So I say to anybody that's interested in getting involved, whether it's a Schutzen club, a ring club, a PSA club, is, make the contact, try to make arrangements to go out there and visit without a dog. Don't even take a dog. Just go out there and see if it feels right. Some people, training has changed so tremendously since when I first started. It's unbelievable. Sometimes I wonder how I ever even got a dog titled back then, because nowadays, whew, it's hard. Right. But go out there and meet the people and watch the training, and if you like what you see, ask some questions, see about getting in on a probationary, membership. And I'll tell you one thing that was said to me when I first got into dog sports, and this was by Dr. Annetta Cheeck back in Virginia, very first person I ever met that had a Schutzen 3 pit bulldog. She was the reason that I got involved with Schutzen. And she says, your decoys, whoever works your dog for you, endear them to you, bring them gifts, bring them goodies. You've got to keep them healthy. You've got to keep them happy. Without our decoys, whether it's a suit or a sleeve, without decoys, we're simply an obedience club. So decoys are very, very important. And all of them have good things to offer. So.
Yep. All right, we have another guest or another caller calling in. This is Jacob. I think Jacob has a dog with him. Jacob, how's it going?
Yes. Good. Hi, this Jacob. Is hi Leri. This is Zeus.
Zeus. Is that my Zeus?
That's your Zeus.
Oh, those are my people. Oh. Hey Zeus.
Hey, I had a question.
How you doing, buddy?
What's your question, Leri? I mean, Jacob, sorry.
The question is, who is your favorite American Pitbull Terrier?
Of my own or just out there, period?
Out there, period.
Oh, man, you put me on the spot. There's a lot of dogs that I like. A lot of them are now gone, but they were very influential to me when I was first starting, and like Baroness, Cheeks Red Baroness. She was an incredible dog. She was a strong Schutzen 3 contender. She was an excellent house dog, family companion. You could take her to the hospital, you could take her on a plane. Lisa Berry had a little dog, a little bitch named Siren. And Siren was pretty incredible also. I think that Siren's gone now. She wasn't much to look at. She was kind of junk parts. But that dog's head and heart were pretty incredible. And you notice those are two bitches that I'm talking about. I have a tendency to gravitate towards the females because in most working breeds, females aren't generally worked. It's usually the males that get that. That attention, and the females, good females, are kept just for breeding. So to me, it's really nice when you have a good working female. But I love Zeus also. He's one of my favorites too.
All right, Jacob. Thanks a lot, man. Thanks
for calling. Bye, Leri.
Bye, sweetie.
All right, there you go. I think he had an answer already in mind for that question. Like he was. You know.
Zeus is a good dog. That's what I was saying, Zeke. I've come across this past year, you know, several young pit bull dogs still under a year that any one of them, I would be tickled if they were mine.
Right.
They're
right.
Just nice dogs. Nice dogs. For competition, too. Yeah.
Yeah.
And nice. Easy on the eye.
Easy. Yeah. Well, you know what? That's one thing. Hold on one second. I think Stetson's calling. Give me one second. Let's see. All right, there you go. We got Stetson calling in. Hey, Stetson.
Hey, Stetson.
Can't hear you, bro. Can't hear you.
Oh, darn.
What about now? Can you guys hear me now?
There you go.
All right, perfect. Thank you so much. Sorry about that. My phone died right when you brought me on last time, and then I'm trying to use my headset on my wife's phone.
Okay.
So I keep hearing you say the pit bulldog, and I was just curious your thoughts on the working pit bulldog, the newer ADBA classification, and how you felt about that, if they maybe, or what you know, if they perform better for the sport and personal protection thing.
Okay, yeah.
Or if you're just using that name.
Well, when I say pit bulldog, you know, it's kind of across the board from AKC Amstaff to UKC Show Dog to ADBA Game Bred and even to the rescues out there. I mean, because our standard is so loose, I'm kind of in general saying if they look like a pit bulldog, I'm calling them a pit bulldog. There are some really fantastic rescues out there too that are in one here in the Oxnard Westlake Village Santa Barbara area, and then another one up in Northern California. I have no idea what they're breeding is. One of them's a blue dog, and they're pretty incredible dogs. I kind of for several years my sport dogs were UKC show dogs for the most part. And then what I like to consider my best sport dog, I don't know if she was or not. I guess best is, depends on best of what, you know, whatever you're into. She was a little game bred bitch. And I've kind of gotten into a habit of where whenever I get a new dog, I don't necessarily want a dog. This is for me. I don't necessarily want a dog that comes from generations of working titled stuff. I want one that hasn't been tested at all in that type of venue. Because we know what some of the others can do, and that's good. And all of them, in my opinion, have pros and cons. They have strengths and weaknesses. So I feel that, and I learned this from one of my friends, Salvatore, in Italy. I asked him, why do you import all these American dogs? You have such beautiful Italian-bred dogs here. He says, because the more dogs, the more lines, more blood I can get my hand on, the more I better understand the breed. And I'm like, ah, yeah, I like that. So that's kind of where I'm going, even with my training. And I think, especially for breeders, if you're not testing your dog in a legal, legitimate, accredited sport, you really don't even know what you have, because you discover a lot about your dog once you start putting them to the test. So I don't know if that answered your question or not.
It gave me the information I think I was looking for, so I really appreciate that.
Welcome.
And I really liked the part how you said testing something that doesn't have generations in the past. That's kind of what I took on myself from the videos that Zeke makes, what I learned online after my Doberman died. And I found myself, he's an ABKC bully, but he's very classic, like the late 90s look and temperament. And I've, you know, trained him. He just turned two, and I've been working on getting him very, you know, protection, not the sport side of things. So, and it's working out very great. So you have always interested me. When I heard you were coming on, I had to call and talk to you. So thank you so much for taking my call. And thank you for all that you do, Zeke.
Oh, thank you, bro. I appreciate you.
Good luck with your bully too. Dave's doing some pretty incredible, real deal Dave, is doing some pretty incredible stuff with some bullies out there. I never thought bullies had that side of them. That protection side, holy smoke, they do. So good luck.
Yeah, he will not let, I'm sorry. We have five kids. He will not let any strangers get close to our kids. He's very, very protective of them, and he's very good with them too. So very gentle. The oldest is 8, so they're little kids too. And he's very gentle with them, but if a stranger comes up, until he looks for me for, you know, what do I do? And until he knows that person's okay, he looks very scary. So just the look of it, but he will light up if need be. So
nice. Good for you. You're lucky.
Thank you.
All right.
Yes, so I've been very blessed.
Thanks for calling in, man.
Thank you
guys for your time. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay. See, yeah, you had a bully at one point in time.
I still do.
Okay.
I still do. And Junior's he's going to get a trip out to Dave, and we're going to see what we got going on there.
How old is he now?
7.
Okay, yeah, I was going to say, it's been a minute since we did that video.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He's doing good. He's fine.
So what are you
hanging out?
Is he in the room with you?
Yeah,
he's sleeping. Is that who you looking at? Okay. Yeah.
Let's see if I can.
There he is.
There he is. Yes. Thon logs.
I love that. All right, we have a Ryan's calling in. Let's get a Ryan on the phone real quick. So you thought no one was going to call in, right? You thought,
yeah, I'm glad.
Listen, we're getting buzzed, man. Ryan, how's it going, bro? Turn the lights on.
Hello.
Man. Look, we got it looking like a horror movie over there.
Hi, Ryan.
Hello. I have a question. The game dogs, the game American Pitbull Terriers, are they 100% animal aggressive?
Not always. You know, when you talk about animal aggression, and this is something that I discovered really early on in the ABBA show ring, is sometimes I go in there with a trained dog, you know, so they're not going to act completely stupid if I'm at the end of the leash, you know, so they're looking, but they're not losing their mind. And I've had more than one judge say to me, that's more how the dogs should act when they're lunging and flipping over and frothing at the mouth. It's kind of like I don't want to say this. I mean, this isn't completely true, but the all bark, no bite. When you have a dog that looks super, super strong, and then you open the gate and then he runs the other way. It can be that same way too, once that line is off. So Animal aggression and gameness are not, they don't necessarily go hand in hand. Your dog doesn't have to want to kill every creature in sight in order to be deemed or tested game. And you can have a go ahead.
I forget I was going to say.
It's okay. You can have a game-bred dog, though, that can mind his manners around other animals. That doesn't just happen by accident. Of course, the owners have to put a little bit of work in there, too. But, you know, you'll hear the stories, too, about some of the best game dogs would walk the yard with the owners when they fed the other dogs that were on the chains. They knew when they were supposed to do their job. Wasn't like they were just kill crazy.
Oh. Yeah, I was just wondering. I thought like American Pitbull Terriers are animal aggressive because it's the standard of the breed.
Mm-hmm.
And they're very friendly. Like they're friendlier than a Labrador. And I heard that it's I don't know if it's true or not, but it's impossible to do protection work with them because they're super friendly. Is that true?
Well, I've done it, and I know other people who have done it with game-bred dogs. And then we start talking about different sports, too. For example, in some of the sports, you have to have multiple dogs, two dogs on the field at the same time. And so for some of us, we're like, I don't know if that's going to be a good sport for this particular dog. And then there's the ring sports, Mondio and French Ring, for example. I think PSA also, I'd have to double check, where you're the only dog on the field at that time. However, you still always, in any of the sports, you have to pass a temperament test. And the temperament test isn't just with people. It's also the dog needs to be able to pass another dog without losing his mind. Here's kind of to sum it up. For sport dogs, there's no room for aggression. No room for dog aggression. If your dog is more interested in fighting another dog than it is performing, you need to do something else because we don't want to risk our dog injuring somebody else's companion and competition dog ever, right? So yeah. If you have, and I had a dog like that. It was Hai Trong's litter mate to his male, Nala. Nala was, I got her at about, 4 years old. And I was smitten right away. I thought this is going to be the best dog I ever had. She didn't have a whole lot of training. Weight pull training is what she had. And I couldn't get her past her interest in animals, period. Didn't even have to be dogs. It could be squirrels. It could be birds, cats, whatever. And I'd get really good training here at home. And when I would take it away from home, to the training field or even in the front yard, I struggled. I struggled really, really hard. And I eventually, I let her go too because, that's the thing about realistic expectations. You got to look at the animal and kind of by training it, you get a better feel for if that's going to be the teammate that you're looking for. Is the dog going to be able to keep it together, for the length of time that you're on the field or during training or what have you? Some dogs are just so far out there. And Wes is a good example too. I mean, he can be very convincing in the ADBA show ring to look like a real, monster. But at the same time, I could say, Wes, heel. And Wes would go. Because he's had training. I don't think that goes across the board. Not in my experience anyway.
Oh. The breed itself is not a solitary dog or anything, so it can get along like with a pack of dogs or etc.
All right, in my experience, again, I have had game dogs, game bred dogs that lived in my small pack with my Malinois, my band dog, my bully, my Patterdale, whatever. However, anytime I'm not home, if they're not supervised, the bulldog's locked up. I'm just not going to take that kind of chance. And I suggest that to even the people I work with when they're really tickled and really happy that their dog gets along so well with other dogs. I say, be careful, because it's quick and it's dog fights are no fun. For me, they're no fun. No bueno.
Mm-mm. All right, Ryan. Thanks for the call, man.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
All right, well, take it easy. Yeah, I mean, that's one of the things I think people have got to understand is that, I've seen dogs who didn't really know, want to fight till they had a fight, right? So once they kind of got into one, then they understood, like something unlocked in their brain, like, oh, you know, and then at that point.
You're so right, Zeke. And I was warned very early when I got Cassie. I didn't know anything about her bloodline, just that everybody said, oh, that's a good bloodline. And somebody, this is in the AOL days, said to me, do yourself a favor. If you want to do your little protection sports, never, ever let her get in a mix-up with another dog. Don't let her know that she can fight. Because once she knows, then you're going to have a problem.
Right.
And interestingly enough, I ended up giving her to Diane Jessup. Diane is a very well-known pit bull enthusiast, animal control officer, competitor, breeder. She's been around a long, long time. People love her or hate her. I love her.
Right.
I gave her Cassie, and there was a yard fight. And from that day on, she said Cassie was always different. Even in her bite work, she was trying to cross her over from Ring to Schutzen. She says it was different once she got in a tango. And she says, believe me, Larry, she lived true to her breeding. So I was very, very careful with her in never letting her get in a mix-up. But when it happened, then she's like, oh, yeah, I like this.
Yeah, so yeah.
Your all point right, was well taken, and I agree.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to wrap it up now, 7:43. We want to keep this under an hour. I do appreciate your time. I knew you would be well received. That's why I wanted to have you on. Anything that you ever want to do, you have any product or books or video thing series that you want to get out to the world, we can do this again.
Hey, can I just say something real quick before we go?
Sure thing.
It's still in the making, and although it's supposed to be end of September, the Working Pitbull Terrier Club of America, which is a member club of the American Working Dog Federation. We're trying to put together our national championship, which we haven't had in close to 10 years since Noel Nasca hosted it in New York. It may be difficult to travel at that time in September to the East Coast, but for anybody that has an interest, please reach out myself or on Instagram, Facebook, the Working Pitbull Terrier Club of America. If you want more information, we'd love to have you out there.
Okay. So the Working Pitbull Terrier Club of America has an Instagram and a Facebook.
That's right.
Right. So guys, if you wanted to find out more about this national show, national competition, go there and do your inquiry.
Awesome. Right. Thank you, Zeke. Right.
Thank you so much, Larry. I really, really, really appreciate you.
Anytime.
Because I realize you also were probably want to put me in contact with Diane Jacobson. Diane, what was your last name?
Jessup.
Yeah, Diane Jessup. Yeah. My memory ain't what it used to be. But so, yeah, Diane Jessup, who I did another video with, which I think is a very important video that I have on my channel. So, see, your fingerprints are all over Dogumentary TV. I really, really, really appreciate you. Yeah, I appreciate
you. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Have a great evening. And I'll talk to you soon.
We'll talk again soon.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.
All right, guys. There you go. Leri Hanson, amazing dog trainer, wonderful person, wonderful woman, doing things with dogs. A lot of things that some of you macho guys out there say women can't do, that women can't handle this, women can't handle that. I don't say those things anymore because I've been around women like Leri Hanson, Annie Wild Moser. I've been around some women who handle serious dogs. And I know that, you know, if a woman wants to do it, a woman can do it. All right, guys. So this is pretty much going to be the wrap up of this video. I hope you guys enjoyed it. If you guys haven't had the time already, just, you know, leave a comment. Let me know what you guys are thinking. If there's anybody that you want to see in the future, any videos you want to see in terms of these live streams, Just leave them in the comments section. You can actually hit me on my Facebook or my Instagram page as well, which is just Dogumentary TV. You can find me there. All right. Thanks, guys. I appreciate you guys. I will talk to you shortly. All right. Peace.